From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say,
take our country back. We're going to take it back.
USA! 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 USA!
Well, we start by saying, hello, Iowa. This is a great place. We're going to have a big year. Happy New Year, by the way. And 10 days from now, the people of this state are going to cast the most important vote of your entire lives. You know, I said it in 2016, I said it, and I meant it. And then we did a great job, and we had a rigged election, unfortunately, but we're going to change that around. We're not going to let them do it. We're not going to let them do that. But, you know, there were so many things that we did that I never really said that in 2020. We had a safe border. We had the safest border in the history of our country. So I never said it, really. But now I can tell you, we have the worst border. We have the worst president in history. We have a president that can't put two sentences together. We have a president who can't walk off the stage. See this? He can't find the steps. Can't find the steps. Now we have a president who's a great danger to democracy. He really is. He is a danger to democracy, and at a level like few people have seen. By delivering a massive victory in Iowa, you will send a thundering message straight to crooked Joe Biden, the fake news media, a lot of them back there. That's a lot of fake news back there. They had to travel all the way up here. Look at the crowds we have, huh? People outside, too. And all of the evil and sinister people trying to destroy our nation, and that's what they're trying to do, is one of two things. They're either very stupid or they're trying to destroy the nation. And I don't think they're stupid because they wouldn't be able to cheat so well in elections, right? So they're trying to destroy our country. With your vote for our campaign on Monday, January 15th, you will declare that we are going to take back our country. We are going to defeat crooked Joe Biden. And we are going to make America great again. We have to. And it all starts here in Iowa at 7 p.m. It's on Martin Luther King Day. You can't forget. And we're going to do something. And here's the thing. We have these polls that show us we're 35, 40 points up. Forget them. Pretend we're 1 point down, like you young guy in the front with a beautiful hat on. Pretend we're 1 point down. Forget about 35, 40 points up. You know, nationwide, We're 64 points up. Okay, 64 points up. And I think in your state we're like 40, but forget that. Pretend you're down 1 point. What do you think, Mike? Is that good? That's a good idea, right? 1 point down, but you have to get out and vote because it sets a tone. It even sets a tone, frankly, for November, because we have to bring it back from these lunatics that are running our country. Do not stay home. If you want to save America, each and every one of you has to get out. You have to get out and vote. And, boy, I tell you, the biggest risk is you say, you know, we're winning by so much, darling. Let's stay home and watch television. Let's watch this great victory. And if enough people do that, it's not going to be pretty. But we're not going to let that happen. You know, I'm going to be here. You know that, right? I'm coming to Iowa. I'm going to caucus. I'm going to caucus. We're going to be in Iowa. We're not taking any chances, right? You know, they're spending a lot of money. The globalists have given her money. And you know, I know very well, she ain't going to do it. I can tell you, she's not going to do it. And I know him very well. Both disloyal, both extremely disloyal. Him, I got elected. He was down at like nothing, came over, begged me for an endorsement. You know that better than anybody, right? Begged me for an endorsement, and he helped me a little bit with the impeachment hoax, number one, impeachment hoax, number two hoaxes. We had about 15 hoaxes. We have currently a lot of hoaxes going on, too. They never stop. And you think they won't do it to them? They would do it to them, too, but they would wilt. They would wilt. But he came over, tears in his eyes, I need your endorsement. And he was losing by like 35 points. It was over, and then for whatever reason, stupidly, I gave him my endorsement, and he went up like a rocket ship, and that was his only claim to fame, and he ended up getting it. And then I got him past the general election. We did two or three rallies. They were big, beautiful rallies. And I said, you're going to win. He said, I don't think so, because the man he was running against was the hottest politician in the country. I said, you're going to win. I'm telling you. I could tell by the rallies. The rallies were incredible. And he won. And then 4 years later, they said, will you run against the president? And he said, I have no comment. I said, that means this guy's running. And that was the end of him, right? So now in Florida, a poll came out today. I'm at 89 and he's at 9. And now I guess he's fighting for second place, isn't he? They're both fighting for second place. You can have either one of them, globalists. But we're thrilled to be joined today by some incredible people. State Senator Brad Zaughan. Now, Brad was the first person in the United States, the whole country, to endorse me. Does anybody know that? He endorsed me 3 months before I ran. Nobody knew I was running. I didn't know I was running. I really didn't. I didn't know. One day I said, come on, First Lady, let's take that trip down that beautiful escalator, First Lady. But Brad was there 3 months before I was. Can you believe it? So, and he's a great guy wherever he may be. Where's Brad? Where's Brad? Brad. I call him the Marlboro Man. He's a handsome guy. 3 months. You remember that, Brad? I said, who's that guy in Iowa? I didn't know him. I said, who's the guy in Iowa? He keeps endorsing me. He likes me. And I got to meet him, and I like him a lot. He's a fantastic guy, and he loves your state. He loves our country. Thank you very much, Brad. We appreciate it. And state representatives, fantastic people. They all endorsed, and they're all really right out there. Derek Wolf, wherever Derek may be. Derek. Hi, Derek. Thank you. Great job, Derek. They like you, Derek. Charlie Thompson. Charlie, thank you. Thank you very much, Charlie. A friend of my former Congressman, Rob Blum. We should take that former. Hi, Rob. We should take that former. Oh, wait, you feel like running for Congress? I have a couple of positions for you in Iowa. I have a couple we could do without. Do you feel like running? I have a couple of ideas. Former acting attorney general, a friend of mine, Matt Whitaker. Very popular, Matt. He's very popular. Good guy. He's a good football player, too, by the way. The stakes of this election could not be higher. It can't be higher. And by the way, I just spotted him, a man who is the single greatest buyer of commercials in the history of television, Mike Lindell. And his pillows are good also. His pillows are very good, but if he could buy our ads for us, I would say that we would have ads just blanketing the nation for about one-third the price, I suspect, right? No, you're great. He's a great guy. He's always a popular person, too. We introduce him. People love him. I love him. Under crooked Joe Biden, our borders have been literally erased. Millions of illegal aliens are invading our country. They're coming from all over the world. Nobody knows who they are, where they're from. Countries that nobody ever heard of. Languages that we don't have people to teach these languages. We don't even know what the languages are. They're coming from all over the world. Our middle class is being crushed by Biden's crippling inflation like we have never seen before, really. Violent criminals are running wild in Democrat-run cities while law enforcement has been weaponized against Christians, conservatives, and people of faith. We have war in Europe, war in the Middle East. China is threatening Taiwan. Iran is inches away from a nuclear bomb. They think Iran's going to have a nuclear weapon over the next 61 days. Can you imagine the stupidity of these people? We had it so good. When I was president, Iran was broke. They had no money. I told China, if you deal with them, you can't deal with us. I told that to India. I told it to France. I told it to every nation. And they were broke, and I wasn't looking to hurt them. I just don't want them to have a nuclear weapon. And they weren't going to have one. And when bad things happened in that election, all of a sudden, this guy comes in, takes all the sanctions off. Iran is now a very rich nation. They have $250 billion in cash. Can you believe it? Not even mentioning the $6 billion they got for five hostages. How about $6 billion for five hostages? I'll tell you what, you know, if it was me, I'd say we got to give them up for that kind of money. $6 billion for five. You know, I heard about it. It was five and five. I said, okay, now tell me that's the end, right? Because we have Brittany Griner. And for Brittany Griner, well, you're just upset because she always believed in tying her shoelaces during the national anthem, right? Remember? That was when she tied her shoelaces during the national anthem. But for that, they got the greatest arms dealer, they say, in the history of mankind. That was the trade, and he's out there buying arms for Russia right now and happily buying all sorts of military equipment. That was a tough trade, I'll tell you. And then we left the one person behind. He couldn't. They said, oh, we'll get him later. Well, that was already a year ago. Now, what kind of deals do we make? Those are the deals that this country makes. But that was bad. And then I said, okay, we got six, this one. So we got five. They got five. I said, well, that's a little better, although I'd like to know, you know, who are our fives? Are they the greatest arms dealer? And we're giving you somebody that's not the same? But it turned out, well, they said, sir, that's not all of it. In addition to the five and five, we're giving them $6 billion. Oh, that's more like it. That's more like our country. How stupid are we? How stupid are we? And they have now, if you think, they're about $250 billion. They've made it all in a three-year period. They had nothing. They were down to broke. They were broke. Actually, a Democrat congressman was on last week, 2 weeks ago, I think, on Deface the Nation. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Donald Trump on Deface the Nation. And it is, they hate when I say that. You know, they spend all this money on PR people to, you know, to clean up their act. There they are right back there, you know, fakers. And then Trump gets on and he calls them Deface the Nation and all the different names we have for the different crooked media. The media is really crooked. But they also, you know, for giving electricity to Iraq, we gave them $10 billion. You've probably heard about that. But I'm not even talking about that. I'm talking about from the oil. They took off all the sanctions. You couldn't do it with me and took off all the sanctions almost immediately. And they now have $250 billion, and they're giving the money to Hamas. They're giving it to Hezbollah. They're giving it to everybody. Our military leaders have gone woke, and we're teetering on the brink of World War III. And I am the only candidate in this race who's up to the task of saving America from every single Biden disaster, starting on day one. I know everybody. Thank you. You could sit down. Go ahead. Sit down. Oh, we have some front row Joes. You know, these people, I don't know, they must be rich. Stand up. These are, you know, rich people because I see them at every event. They're like at 167 in a row. What do? You must be loaded, right? Loaded with cash. But you know what he is more than he's a great American, and they are great Americans. Thank you very much. Thank you. Great people. Great people. There's so many events. It's beautiful. We have a lot of people that go to a lot of events. We have people that are well over 100. That group from a group of beautiful ladies from North Carolina, right? They've gone to, I think, 117 now. I say, are your husbands happy with you? I don't know. But they're great people. Since 2016, you have been in this battle side by side. We've worked side by side, taking on the entire corrupt system in Washington like no one has ever done before. Nobody's ever done what we've done. You know, we had, prior to COVID coming in, a gift from China. That was a beauty, right? But we had a meeting with John McLaughlin, the great pollster, and a couple of others, and they said, sir, if George Washington and Abraham Lincoln came back from the dead and they decided to run as president and vice president, you'd beat them by 35 points. Because this place, this country was rocking. We were beating China. You know, I put tariffs. We're taking in hundreds of billions of dollars from China. Nobody had ever, it really slowed them down. In fact, they're trying to get rid of the tariffs, but they can't because they're producing so much money. Biden would love to get rid because, you know, he got paid off by China, a lot of money. So he wants to do whatever he can to keep them happy. But it's terrible. I mean, he's like a Manchurian candidate. This is what we have as a president. It's a terrible thing. Together, we stood up to the failed establishment, the corrupt media. Those people right back there. Look at all those cameras. We stood up to the deep state, the globalists, the warmongers, the Wall Street special interests, the open borders fanatics, and the radical left. And we achieved more than any administration just about in the history of our country. We rebuilt our military. Think of it. We got the largest tax cuts in history, the largest regulation cuts in history. We did things like right to try, where people were terminally ill and they couldn't get some of the really advanced medicines. We have the greatest labs and the greatest doctors in the world for all of that. And you couldn't, you know, they'd travel to Asia, they'd travel to Europe, they'd travel all over the world. If they had no money, they'd go home and they'd die. But right to try gave them the right to use this, these great, I mean, we've saved thousands and thousands and thousands of people. One of those people is with us today, actually. Natalie, I don't know if Natalie's around, but she's with us today. Where is she? Where would Natalie be? But right to try was an amazing thing. She works with us. She works so hard. She's usually back working on the computer while I'm speaking. That's extremely insulting, but that's okay. Because she's heard this speech many times before. But we always change up our speeches, don't we, huh? You know, a lot of politicians, they go around and they say the exact same speech for months. Months and months. Not a word changed. It doesn't, even if history is changing in front of their very eyes, it's that same speech over and over again. And then they wonder why nobody listens. With me, there's always a risk, especially when I go off these suckers, right? Right? But with your vote in these caucuses, we're going to finish the job once and for all. We're going to do things and we're going to make history. Look, this is the greatest movement of all time. Make America great again. You know, we had a great election in 2016. We did much better in 2020. We got many millions more votes. We did, you know, I tell people, what was the difference? I said, well, we did much better in 2020. We got millions of more votes. I was told that if we got the same 63, and McLaughlin, who's here someplace, John McLaughlin, if he's around, come on up, John, you can talk about it. I'm sure he didn't expect this. But he's a great pollster, considered, you know, one of the true greats ever. And he said, sir, if you get 63 million votes, the same as we got in 2016, there's no way you can be beaten. So we got 75 million votes. But we got, that's what they say. but we got much more than that. That's what they say. So we got millions and millions more votes. And then they said, oh, we just lost by just a tiny bit, these people. And think of it. All those people are dead in Ukraine. It would have never happened. Dead in Israel would have never happened. Israel would have never been attacked. Ukraine would have never been attacked. We wouldn't have had inflation. China wouldn't be looking at Taiwan. They're thirsting for Taiwan. They wouldn't have even been, they wouldn't be thinking about it. North Korea was happy with me, and they're not happy right now. Together, we've fought long and hard to rescue the Republican Party from the likes of Mitt Romney, Karl Rove, Paul Ryan, right? The wheelchair over the cliff, right? Paul Ryan, the wheelchair over the cliff. He was great. And there's no chance we're going to let them claw their way back into power with the establishment pawns like Rhonda Sanctimonious and Nikki Haley. Or even worse, Joe Biden. Joe Biden is the worst. He's the worst president. He's the most corrupt president. And he's the most incompetent president. Other than that, I think he's doing quite a good job. Quite good. He's doing quite a good job, right? He's the most incompetent president we've ever had. And I say it, you could take the 10 worst presidents in history, add them up together, and they haven't done the damage to this country that this guy has done. Our country is dying, and this is no time to waste your vote on another establishment career politician. And, you know, look, I say we have a very big lead over these people. But you just can't take a chance. You don't know. I mean, it's elections, and a lot of things happen with elections. We learned that. But they're not going to be able to carry the water, and there's a bad seat. You know, when you get people in, how about Nikki? She'd go, I would never run against our president. He's the greatest president. He did a great job. He was a great president. I would never run. This goes on for 2 years. You know, I'd never run against the president. Then one day I heard she's having a news conference. I'm going to be running for the presidency. She doesn't have what it takes. I will tell you that. I know her very well. Unlike every other candidate in this race with me, you know that in your heart, I am the only one that puts America first. I put America first. And with God's help, I will get the job done like I did before. A vote for Donald Trump and the caucuses is a vote to secure our border. It's a vote to stop the invasion. It's an invasion on our southern border. It's a vote to rescue our economy. It's a vote to reclaim our democracy from crooked Joe Biden and his criminal thugs that work with him. It's horrible. The people that work with him are horrible. What they've done with the election, I mean, I got more indictments than Al Capone. Did you ever hear of Al Capone? It's true. Alphonse Capone, the great Alphonse Capone. He was so nasty that if he had dinner with Mike Lindell and Mike smiled, that beautiful smile he's got, Al might think that it was a mocking type smile. Mike would be dead tomorrow morning. Nobody would know. Mike, it would be so painful. He's not into that. But I have worse than Al Capone, okay? And he's about as bad as you get, right? He was a mean guy. This was never in my plan, being indicted for it. I got indicted. I had a period. I was being indicted so fast, we didn't know where the hell they were coming from. If I flew over in my beautiful plane, I flew over a blue state, the next day I'd get served with a subpoena. But you know, the good thing is probably I'm 25 points higher than I would have been. I mean, we would have won easily anyway, but we're in record stratosphere because people get it. People get it. They've weaponized the Justice Department, and they're a disgrace to the whole world. They're a disgrace. The whole world is watching, and they get it. This election is our last chance to save America. The battle begins in Iowa on January 15th, and Joe Biden's banana republic ends on November 5th, 2024. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. With your help, we're going to bring our country back from hell. Victory cannot come soon enough. As we speak, the last remnants of our open border, it's a broken, disgusting, crumbling, horrible border. No country has ever had a border like this. The poorest country in the world never had what's happening. You look at these scenes of millions of people coming across our border. I think it's going to be 15 or 16 million people. That's more than New York State. That's more than almost any state. A couple have a couple more, but they'll catch them in 2 years. It's horrible. People are going into schools now. They're occupying schools. They don't speak the language. They don't even know what the language is. They're sitting with your children in schools. They're occupying the hospital beds. And look, we all have a heart. We don't want that to happen. We don't want bad people to be hurt. But they shouldn't be coming up. They shouldn't be coming here. And the way they don't come here is you say, I'm sorry, we can't take you, so that when they do come, you don't feel so bad about turning them back. But we accept everybody, and we can't take care of them. It's unsustainable for a country. It's unsustainable. This is the largest illegal mass migration in history. There's never been anywhere in the world. There's never been anything like this, where 15 or 16 million people are going to come across the border over a short period of time. A record 300,000 illegal aliens were detected crossing the border in December alone. 300,000 in December. In December. We had the safest border in history. Think of it. We had the safest border in history 3 years ago. And now we have the worst border in the history of the world. In the history of the world, there's never been anything like what's happening. We built 561 miles of border wall. Nobody gives us credit for it, you know. If a 2x4 is laying on the ground that's 50 years old and rotted, they said, you didn't build a new wall. That was a renovation. Okay? So they said, yeah, we built over 500 miles of wall, but a lot of it was renovation. You'd have a piece of steel that's 90 years old laying in the ground that you don't even know if it's steel. It's rotted, rusted. And we dig down 9 feet deep and 30 feet high with steel, with rebar, with concrete. It's that wall is exactly what Border Patrol wanted. It has an anti-climb provision at the top. I never liked the look of it, to be honest. It has a panel on top. It's called anti-climb. I said, I'd like to leave it off because I'm a very aesthetic person. I said, it looks better without it. They said, the difference is they can climb over the wall the other way. They can't climb it. It's called anti-climb. I said, all right, I'll give it to you. I gave it to Border Patrol. We have unbelievable Brandon Judd. And then we have the great Tom Homan. You know that Tom Homan, Central Casting. I'd say he is Central Casting, right? And he's a great guy. And we have incredible people. All they had to do is leave it the way it was. We had the record in like 38 years, the record lows. And if Biden just went to the beach and left everything alone, but they couldn't do that. He goes to the beach. He can't even lift one of those little aluminum chairs that are meant for children to pick up. He's not strong enough to do it. Remember when he used to say, I'd like to take him behind the barn. I hit a long ball, you know, shh. But I'd like to take him behind the barn and say, then I'd teach him. If he ever did that, you know what I'd do? I'd go, and he'd fall down. He'd fall down, go. But he used to say that it was fine. If I ever said that, oh, that's terrible. He's a fascist. He's horrible. You know, if I ever said that about him, I'm going to take him behind the barn and I'm going to beat the hell out of him. They'd say, he's a fascist. He's horrible. But when Biden says it, oh, isn't that nice? I guess they probably know in that sense, physically, he's harmless. And mentally, he's harmless, too. But he's got a lot of people around him that are bad news. And we get Mexico. You know, we got Mexico to give us 28,000 soldiers worth billions and billions. You know, when they say, he didn't get money from Mexico. What do you mean? I got more money than even if they... There was no legal mechanism for them to build the wall, give us the wall, build it. But they could give us soldiers. I got 28,000 soldiers from Mexico. And everyone said that would be impossible. And the head of... You probably heard this story, but the head of the State Department, one of the top people who dealt only with Mexico for 24 years, I think, she said, sir, you're never going to get this. I said, no, I want to get it. We'll get it 100%. She said, you're not going to get it, sir. And she was a good woman. She was just a lousy negotiator. And I said, no, we'll get it. And she said, what else are you going to answer? I'm going to say, remain in Mexico. I want everybody to remain in Mexico. And I want catch and release in Mexico, not catch and release into the United States, and about 9 or 10 other things. Then I asked Tom Homan and I asked Brandon Judd, give me the top 10 things. They gave me. So we came in with like 12 items, 10 or 12 items. Every one was impossible. The big one was, we want the soldiers for nothing. We're not going to pay you anything. And the representative of the president, and the president's a great guy, he's a socialist, but he's a great guy anyway, you know. And he came over, handsome man, very good-looking man, dapper. And what can we do for you, President? I said, here's the story. You're going to give us 28,000 soldiers. No. We're not going to give you 28,000. I said, yes, you 100%. 100%. You're going to give us 28,000 soldiers. No, we're not. Yes, you are. Then I said, you're going to give us stay in Mexico. Everyone's going to stay in Mexico. That's the way it is. Nothing you can do about it. Everyone's staying in Mexico. No, we're not going to allow that. Yes, you are. 100%. 100%. He didn't know what the hell was going on because he said no. And I'm saying, of course you are. And then I said, catch and release, but we don't release them in our country anymore. We release them in your country. No. I said, he said, look at me. He goes, why do you keep saying I'm going to? I keep saying I'm not. I said, you're going to. 100% you're going to. Would you like to make a bet? We'll make a bet. And he said, no, I don't understand what you're getting at. I said, here's the story. If you don't give us all of these 12 items, I'm going to put a 25% tariff on every single piece of equipment and car and everything that Mexico sends into our country. And we're going to tariff you at 25%. And after 2 months, it goes to 50%. And after 2 months, it goes to 75%. And that's a lot more money than the cost of the soldiers and the cost of... So they gave us billions and billions of dollars. He said, may I please excuse myself and call the president? I said, good, 5 minutes, come back. So he comes back in five. Sir, it would be a great honor to give you 28,000 soldiers, sir. Be a great honor to give you. Remain in Mexico, sir. Be our honor. We would love to do it. We would love to keep MS-13 in Mexico. You know, we love the roughest gang. So we got everything we wanted. And the woman, I will say this, the woman in the State Department said, I've never seen anything like that in my life. But it wasn't even hard. You want to know the truth. We do many things like that. I did it with France. I did it with a lot of people where they take advantage of our country. And I did it. In France, they were going to charge, you know that story, we're going to charge us 25% our American companies if they do business in France. I said, no, you're not. They're not going to do that. I gave it to my people. 2 months later, they said they couldn't make a deal. I said, I'll make a deal. I called up the head of France, you know, Macron. Do you know Macron? He's a very nice guy, Macron. And really a very nice guy. I said, Emmanuel, how are you? He said, fine. I said, I heard you're going to charge American companies 25% to do things in Mexico. Who else are you doing? Well, nobody yet, but we will do other. I said, no, but you're not going to do it, Emmanuel. You're not going to. No, Donald, it has already passed. I said, well, you better unpass it, because if you don't unpass it, you're going to pay a 100% tariff on all wines and champagnes that are shipped into the United States starting tonight. No, you cannot do that, Donald. You cannot do that. I said, I can do that. In fact, I'm just signing it right now. No. We're not going to do it. That was the end of it, Mike. That was the end of it. It was so easy. And I could tell you 200 things like that. I could tell you 200 things like that. I could tell you about aircraft carriers where they use electric catapults. They couldn't go to the steam, which works better for about 1/100th the price, you know, the electric catapult. You know that story. I could tell you about the elevators on a tremendous aircraft carrier, the Gerald Ford. And they decided not to use hydraulic like a John Deere tractor. They decided to use magnets. We're going to use magnets to lift up the elevators with 7 planes on them. We need them fast, these massive elevators. They used magnets. They wanted to try it for the first time. This was a ship that was supposed to cost $2.5 billion. It cost $19 billion and didn't work and still doesn't, you know. So they use electric catapults instead of the steam, you know, like Victory at Sea. Anybody ever see those planes get thrown off there? Instead, they get thrown off. It's been great for 60 years, but now we decide to go with all electric. You know what you did? Biden must have been involved in that, right? Think. He must have been. So I said, I visited the carrier because I wanted to know, you know, it's only about 7 years late, actually, and costing a fortune, totally out of control. So I go, and they had me meeting an admiral. I said, I don't want to see the admiral. I want to see the people in charge of the catapult. They're catapulters. So these guys come out, one guy named Bill Jones. Bill, hi, Bill. What do you do? Sir, I'm a catapulter. And he's proud of it, too. He's great. I said, so tell me about the electric catapults. He said, they're no good, sir. They don't work. And if they break, we have to send to MIT to get a genius to come in and fix them. Whereas the steam, I could fix it with a hammer and a blowtorch. And when the steam got hit with a wave, which we do a lot, sir, those waves waves are bigger than these ships. He said, when the steam got hit with a wave, sir, it didn't have any impact. In fact, it was nice. We loved it. When the electric gets hit with a little piece of water like this, you could drop it with the glass. That's the end of that system. And I said, so you're saying it's so good. Why did they go to it? Because, sir, it goes back and forth, back and forth. You could do it every But the only problem is, sir, it takes us 99 seconds to load it, so it doesn't help that it goes back. And during that 99, the steam builds up, so a little complicated, but it was pretty simple, actually. I said, so which is better? Tell me. Sir, the steam is much better. And we had, they had a nine, not me, they had a $900 million cost overrun on these stupid electric catapults that didn't work. They had an almost billion-dollar cost overrun on the magnetic elevators. Think of it, magnets. Now, all I know about magnets is this. Give me a glass of water. Let me drop it on the magnets. That's the end of the magnets. Why didn't they use John Deere? Why didn't they bring in the John Deere people? Do you like John Deere? I like John Deere, but with the hydraulic, right? So I said, you're wasting your time. You ought to get rid of it. And then I was angry about it because this thing cost, I think, $18 billion. Can you believe one ship? There's never been anything like it. What a disaster. But one ship cost $18 billion. It was totally out of control. I said, bring in the architect. I want to see the architect. He walks into my office 2 days later. I said, have you ever designed a ship before? Well, not too much, sir. Can you believe this? He's doing the biggest ship. I think it's the biggest ship in the world, actually. It's like landing at Kennedy Airport. And it's amazing. I said, tell me, you moved the tower, you know, the tower that's always in the center and hanging off the side, and it looks great, like the Roosevelt and the other aircraft. We built the tower in the back. And I don't know if you know anything about, by the way, this is more interesting than listening to teleprompter stuff, right? Don't you know? Because it's business. It's like business. But so here, just to finish it up, I said, so let me ask you, for the pilots here, the hardest thing you can do as a pilot is land on an aircraft carrier, because it's big and powerful. They look so big. But when they're in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean or the Pacific Ocean, and you got waves going 15 different ways, and this thing's rocking all over the place, despite all of the stuff, it still rocks like a son of a gun. Actually, some of the greatest pilots can't do it because they may be claustrophobic. So I said, by moving the tower back, you're making that area much thinner to land, and they already have a big problem landing. It's very hard to land a plane on an aircraft carrier. You really have to have talent. So I said, by moving the tower back, because the middle of the boat is the widest part, now the tower hangs out over the sea. But this thing came right to the back. And I said, by doing that, you're really making it much tougher for the pilots, because it's a much narrower runway. Does that all make sense? I said, why did you do that? Nobody's ever mentioned that to us, sir. I said, I don't do this professionally, but I'm very good at design. I said, I also don't like the look. I like the, you know, these things with, boom, they're hanging way out over the side. And you have much more room. Then I asked him one other question. What are all those rooms on the bottom under the tower? Sir, that's for the storage of ammunition. Oh, I see. So the poor captain or admiral sitting up on the deck, If they hit the ammunition, that guy's gone. The tower goes up like a rocket ship, right? Well, we never thought of that, sir. These people, I'm telling you, it's really unbelievable. But there are many, many stories. I could go all night telling you about the stupidity in government. And we correct. He goes, okay, keep doing it. You want to hear about 10 more stories? Yeah. But anyway. You think Joe Biden can tell you about it? He doesn't have a clue. The guy, he cannot, I'm telling you, I saw the other night, he couldn't find the stairs off the stage. He's looking. You ever notice he looks like this? He's finished with the speech, which usually lasts no longer than about 3 minutes, because, you know, the medical stuff wears off after 3 minutes. So he's looking around. And you know, the problem with doing that, I just told another group, we had a couple of meetings today, pretty nice ones in Iowa, but I just told the other group, the fake news is so crooked that when I do that, we're going to have a little fun. I do that. Then they say, Donald Trump was unable to find his way off the stage. It's true, Mike. They do that. They say he's unable to find, or when I mimic him talking, you know, not a good talker. He's not a good talker. So when I mimic him sometimes talking, they show me mimicking, and they say, Donald Trump was unable to get the words out today. No, this guy is, we got a bad guy. He's a bad guy, actually. You know, they try and make him like, oh, he sits in, he's not a nice person. I mean, he will go after his political opponent in a campaign, indict him 4 times. Today, we got charged $370 million fine on a perfect loan. Nobody ever even heard of such a thing, using a statute that's disgraceful. These people are corrupt people, and they're bad people. They're actually very bad people. And we can't let them get away with it. We better win this damn election. I'll tell you, this country's finished. It's finished. It's going to be okay, though, because I think we will. I think we will. I never like to say we will, because that gives it the maloiki, you know, that gives it a little bit of, but I'll tell you, there's never been, nobody's ever seen poll numbers like this. Even the fake news was telling me today, they said they've never seen poll numbers like we have. But now we have to put it away. We got, think of it, 9 days to Iowa. Then we go to New Hampshire, where we're leading by a lot. Then we go to Nevada. Then we go to Nevada, right? Then we go to South Carolina, where I'm leading by, in Nevada, we're leading by 90%. They might not even show up. Then we go to South Carolina, which is so great. Great governor there, Henry McMaster. You know, the reason I chose Nikki is I wanted to get her out so Henry McMaster, who's the lieutenant governor, who endorsed me, and he was great. Nikki endorsed somebody else, and she lost. I had a much better endorsement. And I wanted to get Henry to be the governor, so I got 2 for the price of 1, but he was much more important than Nikki to me. But Ron DeSanctimonious, Nikki Haley, and the rest of the pack will never be able to do what I do and what all of these people do. You know, they're all ready to come back. They say, sir, as soon as you're back, Tom Homan called me the other day, sir, we're all ready to go on the border. And they'll do that thing. They'll fix that border so fast. They'll fix it so fast. And they wouldn't do it for anyone else. They wouldn't even do it for anyone else. We had, think of it, we had the safest border in the history of our country, and then they destroyed it, like, overnight, and people just coming in by the millions and millions. And a lot of people don't understand it, because how can that be good? How can it be good? It's so bad for the country, and I think they really are doing it because they want to sign these people up to vote. I really do. You know, I never would have believed it. They can't speak a word of English for the most part, but they're signing them up. They'll be signing them up, trying to get them in to vote. I think that's why they're doing it, because it can't be... There can't be any other reason. Nikki Haley has been in the pocket of the open borders establishment donors for her entire career. Now, Nikki Haley's campaign is being funded by Biden donors. Did you know that? You got a lot of Biden donors. They're giving a lot of money because they want to take out Trump. Because in the polls, I'm the only one that beats this guy. Can you believe that? Anybody should beat him. See that young man sitting right there? He's like 7 years old. Not you. Right behind. He's 7 years old. He should beat him. I'd vote for him. You know, you give them the store test. Let's say you owned a little store, just an easy store, a little store, like a candy store, right? You know, a lot of candy stores, a little store. Do you think that if you went away for 2 weeks, you'd put Joe Biden in charge? He couldn't run it. He couldn't run a store. He couldn't run a store. If you had a little candy store, Joe, would you take over? How do you run a thing like, he's the president. How do you run this? I don't know. I wouldn't know how to, I wouldn't know where to begin, sir. Nikki opposed my border wall. She condemned my strong border policies. And in 2016, she stabbed the Republican Party in the back by siding with, and she sided with, Barack Hussein Obama. Has anybody ever heard of Barack Hussein Obama? Do you remember Rush Limbaugh? He used to call it, he'd say, ladies and gentlemen, today we'll be talking about Barack Hussein Obama. That was Rush. We miss Rush. We miss Rush. He got the Presidential Medal of Freedom that beautiful night. Do you remember that? Queen Mass Rush. Rush, we need you, Rush. But she sided with Barack Hussein Obama against us on the Trump travel ban, which kept us safe. We didn't have one terrorist attack in 4 years. I never could say it while I was president because I didn't want to do it. And then all of a sudden, the next day, they have an attack. I said, that didn't work out too well. But we didn't have one attack because we were tough. We were very tough on the border. We were very tough with the ban. We had a terror ban, we called it. You know, when somebody comes out of a country that wants to destroy the United States, typically they're not ideal. So I would say, I'm sorry, we're not letting in. Haley recently said Iowa voters will need to be corrected by other states. Now, I don't know if that's, look, I don't know. But it doesn't seem nice, right? You know, I don't want to make, because she also said, you know, they asked her about the Civil War. Why did it start? How did it start? She didn't use the word slavery, which was interesting. I don't know that it's going to have an impact, but, you know, I'd say slavery is sort of the obvious answer. Supposed to about three paragraphs of bullshit. She just talked. Nobody knew what she was saying. But today she put down. Today in New Hampshire, she said you have to be corrected. You don't have to be corrected. You built this country. You built this country. But her record shows that she is one who needs to be corrected because she's the one, and there's nobody better to do that than the people of Iowa. I just vote against her. And just before we get to the sanctimonious, Nikki Haley would also sell you out and grant amnesty to Biden's illegal aliens in her very first way. You know, she said, I will give them amnesty. So they come into the country illegally. You know how many people come into the country through legal means, and sometimes it takes them 10 years, and they have to study or this or that. They have to love our country. And now you have people just pouring across the border. Sadly, the establishment losers and sellouts lagging far behind us in the Republican primary cannot be trusted on taxes, trade, or anything else. They're globalists, and they always will be globalists. You know, when you're a globalist, something wrong with that, because it really hurts our country. It really does. We can help the world, but we have to help our country first, because this is a country that's got a lot of problems. But history will show that there's nothing you can do to change them, and they'll betray you just like they betrayed me. I mean, Ron DeSanctimonious, I endorsed him, and then he says, no, I don't want to comment, meaning, you know, I'm going to run against him. Boy, did I hit him. He doesn't know what the hell happened. I think he's still saying, what happened? He's going around saying, what happened? I used to be popular. He wasn't really popular, and I could tell you a lot of different things. The fact is, you need a personality if you're going to run for office. If you run for office, it's nice if you have a little personality. You don't have to have much, but a little. Good policy and a little personality. Iowa does not want politicians like Ron or Nikki, who both support a 23% national sales tax. How would you like to buy a nice John Deere and say, excuse me, you're going to have to pay 23% sales tax on that tractor? Or how would you like to buy a pillow from Mike Lindell? How would you do if you could charge 23% sales tax, Mike, on the pillow? I don't know. That would be not so good. I think your customers would fly away, right? It's not a good thing. It's not a good thing. And it hurts really the middle class and less than the middle class, much worse than anybody else. You don't want politicians like Ron or Nikki, who both want to gut Social Security and Medicare for our great seniors. That's what they want to do. Ron voted three times to raise the retirement age very substantially on Social Security when he was in Congress. And by the way, nobody liked him in Congress, I will tell you that. Most of Congress has endorsed me. Even in Florida, almost everybody endorsed me. They didn't endorse him. And Nikki says the retirement age of 65 is way too low. It's way too low. Anybody 65 here thinking about Social Security a little bit? You could raise your hand. You don't want to vote for Nikki. That's a lot of people. You don't want to vote for Nikki. Unlike DeSantis and Nikki Haley, we will always protect Social Security and Medicare for our seniors. You know, you're going to be good. I'm not going to do anything. I'm not touching. You deserve that stuff, Medicare and Social Security. But remember this. We have under our feet wealth like no other country in the world has. We have more than Saudi Arabia. We have more than Russia. We have more than any country in the world by far. It's called liquid gold. It's oil and gas, liquid gold. And we were going to, you know, we were drilling. We were number four when I got there. And when I left, we were substantially number one, and we were going to be doubled up what Russia was and what Saudi Arabia. They were number one and two, and we took over number one by a lot. And we were going to be selling to Europe. We're going to be selling to Asia. We're going to make so much money. You didn't have to play around with your Social Security. We were going to be, you know, Saudi Arabia. I said, how much debt do you have to the king? He said, debt? What is debt? I don't know. You know, they bought like 100 777s from Boeing. I said, do you finance them? Finance? No, we pay them cash. We give them cash. We don't have any debt. We don't need to finance anything. Because they have liquid gold. We have more than they do. We were going to make this country so rich. And then this idiot comes along and he stopped everything. And he ended Anwar. Anwar in Alaska is probably the biggest site in the world. It's probably bigger than Saudi Arabia. Nobody really knows for sure, but probably it's bigger. I got it approved. Ronald Reagan couldn't get it approved. I got it approved. In the first week, they ended Anwar in Alaska. People can't believe it. It's not just Alaska. I mean, Alaska couldn't believe it. Economic development, all the jobs. But the whole country in that case, we have the biggest site in the world, and this guy ended it. And he doesn't even know why he ended it. If you say, why'd you end it? He would have no clue. He doesn't know. Somebody told him to end it. On my first day back in the White House, I will terminate every open borders policy of the Biden administration, stop the invasion of our southern border, and begin the largest domestic deportation operation in American history. We have no choice. It's not sustainable. I will shift massive portions of federal law enforcement to immigration enforcement, and we will immediately restore and expand the Trump travel ban on entry from terror-plagued countries. We don't want people from terror-plagued countries. And now one thing has gotten better, if you think about it. What has gotten better under crooked Joe Biden? Nothing. Everything's, I mean, the whole world is laughing at us. No respect, you know? Remember our great comedian, no respect, right? I have no respect. This is like the country's talking about our country, no respect. And they respected us, I'll tell you, they respected us. Again, Russia would have never done Ukraine, never, in a million years. If, number one, they wouldn't have done it because we had the oil prices lower, but they wouldn't have done it even beyond that. You know, oil went up to $100 a barrel. They made a fortune on that. They made a fortune. I had it at $40, and if it stayed at $40, then it would have. There was no reason why it should have gone up. So we wouldn't have had Russia going into Ukraine. We wouldn't have had China drooling over Taiwan. You know, they're drooling over Taiwan. Israel would never, ever have been attacked. It's just all of it. We wouldn't have had inflation. We would have had a great economy. It's incredible what these people have done. It's amazing. If you have a competent president, if you have the right president, it's amazing what the right president can do. But we did things that nobody believed. We rebuilt our military. We did things. We knocked out ISIS, you know. We beat them. Everybody said, well, it'll take 4 to 5 years. I did it in, like, 2 months with General Raisin Kane, right? Right, Mike? General Raisin. What's your name? Kane, sir. What's your real name? Kane, sir. Well, do you have a first name? Yeah, they call me Raisin. I said, wait a minute. Your name is Raisin Kane? I love you, General. This is the general I'm finally looking, not Millie and not all these characters from these television people that don't know what the hell they're doing. Under the Trump administration, you were better off. Your family was better off. Your neighbors were better off. Your communities were better off. And our country was better off. America was stronger, richer, safer, and more confident than ever when you had me behind that beautiful, resolute desk in the Oval Office. The resolute, you know, it's a beautiful desk. A beautiful, beautiful desk with incredible history. You know, they give you a choice of 7 desks when you go and you're president. You have 7 desks. They have these incredible vaults in the White House and in storage areas, and they have different desks. But the Resolute desk to me was so beautiful. It's such a great history. So many great presidents sat behind it, and I chose that. And I'll tell you, your country did really well when I was sitting behind the Resolute desk. You were doing really well. Really well. And we'll do it again. It's no wonder Biden and the far-left lunatics are desperate to stop us by any means necessary. They're weaponizing law enforcement for high-level election interference. It's all election interference. The only thing is, so far, I mean, who knows? Does this go on? So far, they've been great for us. In fact, they don't know what's going on. I heard they were going to indict me two more times, six. I think I must have a record. Who the hell got indicted four times? Two more times, and they said to from what? Don't do it! Don't do it! We're going to indict this guy into the White House. Don't do it. Please, please, they're calling. Please don't indict him anymore. But it's true. It's like the craziest thing, because people get it. You know, they see it. You fight an election? They fought my election. They're still fighting 2016. They all fought it. Everybody in the House fought it. All the Democrat senators fought it. They didn't get indicted. They didn't get sent to jail. The boxes. How about the boxes hoax? Biden has 15 times the number of boxes over 50 years. And he took it. Think of it. He took it when he was a senator. He wasn't allowed to do that. He took it when he was a vice president. He wasn't allowed. I have the Presidential Records Act. I'm allowed to do it. I'm allowed. All that stuff is a hoax. It's a big hoax. And they'll let him get away with it. They let him get away with it, but me, they don't want to let it get. And he has it under his crummy Corvette. You know, he loves that car. I wonder who gave him that car. Which country gave him that car? But he has it on the floor of his Corvette, right? The Corvette runs over, you know, papers from China. It's very interesting. Classified information from China. He sends it to Chinatown. What's that all about? And then it gets sent from Chinatown all over the place. And then they said, oh, he's been cooperating. He's been wonderful. No, he hasn't been wonderful. What he did was, there's a senator named Dick Durbin. None of you would hear of him. He's pretty unimportant. But Dick Durbin, a senator, he said, if he took classified information when he was a senator, that's really, really serious. Wow. I can't believe. He did. Then Dick Durbin said, oh, really, it's not that bad, you know, when he found out. But no, it's bad stuff. But if I do it, it's like a big deal. If he does it, it's fine. It's just incredible the way we have a two-tier system of government. We're going to have to change it. And remember, you know, they have to be careful because this can boomerang, too. You know, it's like we could have done some really terrible things, and it's very bad for our country. They've opened a Pandora's box, which is very, very bad and very dangerous for our country. But all of this is happening because we're beating them badly in the polls. You know, if I wasn't running, or if I was in fifth place, fourth place, like, how about this guy from Arkansas? He's been at zero for a year. Zero. His name is Ada Hutchinson. It's actually Asa, but I call him Ada. Ada Hutchinson. He was the governor of, I don't know, because it's such a great state. Arkansas is a great state. But this guy's been at zero now for about six, 7 months. And if he ever cracked one, I'd be shocked. He's got zero going for him. He's a nasty guy, too. He's a real fresh, nasty guy. But what keeps a man like that running? He's at zero. He goes around campaigning. Oh, you see him. Did anybody ever meet him here? Ada Hutchinson. Were you impressed? No. Who's more impressive, Trump or Ada? You tell me. Now, think of it. He's at zero. He actually, the other day, he had a zero, and the arrow was pointing left. That means he was at less than zero. You know what I figure that is? Less than zero? That's crooked votes. In other words, that's when they actually take away votes. So that would be zero less. That's good. He knows exactly what I'm talking about. In the new morning console poll, which is a big deal, we're trouncing the Republican primary field. Trump is at 66, DeSanctimonious at 11. And Haley at 11. You know, they had a poll the other day where Trump was at 71. Think of it. And Haley was moving up a little bit, like 2 points. I moved up 8 points. She muffed up 2 points. And Ron DeSanctimonious went down 2 points. And the headline was, Haley surges. She was at 11. I was at 74. But she went from 9 to 11. She took over first place by 1 point, and the headline was, Haley surges. It's unbelievable how bad the press is. And it's dangerous for our country, actually, because the press is supposed to be honest, you know, just like the elections are supposed to be honest. We're also leading big here in Iowa, but again, we don't want to take anything for granted, but we're leading by about 40 points in Iowa, but we just... We just can't take that for granted. I don't even want to tell you how well we're doing. I don't want to tell you. I don't want you to walk out of here saying, you know, he's leading by a lot. Let's not bother to vote. Let's watch on television, darling. In the general election, we're crushing Crooked Joe by historic margins in Pennsylvania, Michigan, Nevada, Arizona, Georgia, and North Carolina, Ohio, and Florida. You know, if you win Florida, Ohio, and Iowa, do you know this? There's never been a president that lost the election. Thank you very much, President Trump. They say I lost. If you win, think of it. You're a part of the equation. Historically, lots of elections, right? If you win Florida, Ohio, and Iowa. Now, I won each one in a landslide, okay? So it wasn't even winning. Won plenty of other states, too, that people don't quite know about. But if you win those three, there's never been a president that lost an election except me. Except me. It's an amazing thing. It's a terrible thing. And the people of the country know exactly what happened, and we're going to do it. We're going to do it again. We're going to win a third time, and we're going to straighten out the country. We're going to straighten out the country. But it is true. You know, if I didn't run, or if I was, like, running in third, fourth, fifth place or something, I wouldn't be indicted. They're not going to indict me. They go after the one in first place. You know, they're not stupid. They go after the first. And a lot of people say, they ask me two questions. First, they say, sir, how do you do it? How do you wake up in the morning and put on your pants? And I say, well, I don't think about it too much. I don't want to think about it, because if I think about it too much, maybe I won't want to do it. But I love it because we're going to do something for this country that's never been done before, because this country is finished if we don't win. If we don't win, and you're going to have a stock market crash if we don't win. The stock market's only going up. Do you ever notice that when we go up in the polls, the stock market goes up? It's only because it's a short time. And the stock market only goes up because they think we're going to win. If we didn't win, I think the stock market would be 19. I think it's going to be 1929 depression if we don't win. So it's not recession, depression. It's going to be a 1929 baby. And we can't let that happen. And the second thing is, sir, will they do it again? I've had tough guys, like the toughest guys on Wall Street, you know, very smart, very tough. They're not strong like a lot of you guys. You guys are much more physically fit. These are not, but they're physically fit mentally, very smart. And a lot of the people in the front row know some of them, smartest guys on Wall Street. And really, you know, mentally very strong. They say, how do you do it? These people come at you with subpoenas every day. You go before grand juries. You go before, you have this big slob in New York asking you to pay $370 million penalty for a perfect loan. You had a perfect loan. It was paid. Everything was perfect. I gave the money because the bank wanted. You know, that's what they do. The banks want to loan money. And because my balance sheet is so strong and because my statement, we had an expert witness. He said, it's the best financial statement he's ever seen. And then this person, and it's only political persecution or prosecution. But the next question they say, though, is will it happen again? Those two questions, usually in that order, but sometimes, but that's it. And we're not going to let it happen again. You should all stay in those voting booths. You should stay there and watch. And if you see bags of crap coming into the voting areas, you got to stop it. You can't let it happen, because these guys are crooked as hell. They know how to cheat, and they have no shame. They have no anything. They are crooked as hell. And you can't let it happen, because we're not going to have a country. If they take over this country, if they have another 4 years, I don't know that you're going to get by another 10 months. I mean, you know, 10 months is a long time when you have a grossly incompetent person running something. You could end up in a world war with this idiot. You could end up in a world war, because he has no clue what the hell is happening. And his people don't have a clue either. And they're smart. They're vicious. They're smart. They're communists. They're fascists. But they're smart and they're vicious. But they're the ones running. He doesn't know what the hell he's doing. But they run it. And they're bad people. The radical left Democrats rigged the presidential election of 2020. And we're not going to allow them to rig the presidential election of 2024. And every time the radical left Democrats, Marxists, communists, and fascists indict me, I consider it a great badge of honor. I'm being indicted for you. Thank you very much. I appreciate that, but that's true. But never forget, our enemies want to take my freedom because I will never let them take away your freedom. I'm not going to let them do that. Not going to. They want to silence me because I will never let them silence you. And in the end, they're not after me. They're after you. And I just happen to be standing in their way. I'm in their way. Oh, they would love to get rid of me. They would love to get rid of Trump. Let's get rid of that guy. Do you ever notice what they say? Because they're great disinformation people. Oh, we really want to run against Trump. You know, because they obviously see you're 60 points up or something. It's like, you know, most people would say, like, when's this two very foolish people? When are they getting out? When do they get out? But, you know, they have an ego, too. And they maybe won't get out for a few states. But it looks like we're in very good shape. But just think about it. All of this is going on, all of this. And they always say, we really want to run against Trump. See, it's disinformation. They're the party of misinformation and disinformation. You know, the difference is a slight difference. I won't bore you with it, but there is a difference. But I use them both. Misinformation, disinformation. So I beat Hillary in a big shock. I did much better against, in those days, I called him Sleepy Joe Biden, but I like Crooked Joe. I think it's a more accurate term. Sleepy Joe's good, but Crooked Joe's better. So I took that name off Hillary. You know, I called her Crooked Hillary. Now I call her very beautiful Hillary because she's meaningless. So what I do, so what happened, that was a great day for Hillary when I took that name off, Crooked Hillary, right? It was a good name. I never liked it that much, and all of a sudden it grew. You know, sometimes they grow. A lot of people didn't like the name DeSanctimonious. They thought it was too long. I said, I think it's good. That one turned out to be very good. And we have an abbreviation, DeSanctus, because you can't keep saying DeSanctimonious. So if you say it more than once in a paragraph, you go DeSanctus. But I will tell you that we have a chance to make our country so great. We have one chance. And if we don't take this chance, this country is doomed. It's doomed. A country can be doomed. Other countries were the talk of the world. And fairly short time later, you look at the Roman Empire, you look at the British Empire, you look at so many different empires, they were not even thinking about doom. And this country's not far away. If they had it for another few years, and honestly, even 11 months, it's just too long. So many bad things can happen. This is far more important, a campaign. This is the greatest political movement in the history of our country. Make America Great Again, MAGA. You know, I was going to call it CAG, Keep America Great. But our country is not great. This is not a, we're laughed at all over the world. We don't do well in anything. We have people that go, they don't know. You know, they went to Mexico the other day. Now, I told you my Mexico story, but their story is Mexico wants us to pay them $5 billion. Pay them. They're going to pay them $5 billion. So Mexico wants $5 billion to help us on the border. Think of that. They're not going to pay. They would never even ask me for that. They would just hope. They would just hope that I was a nice person. But they want $5 billion to work with us on the border. And it's Mexico's fault. And it's other countries' fault, too. But it's really our fault because we're really led by very stupid people. Together, we'll once again fight for Iowa families and Iowa farmers, just as we did. I got you $28 billion. $28 billion. I get a lot of heat, you know. Hey, it's great to be on a Friday night, right? You don't have to go to work tomorrow. I do. You know what I have to do? I have to make speeches in Iowa tomorrow. I have to go to work. Oh, I could be home in one of those beautiful places. No, but I have to. But it is great to be. Is there any better place to be than a Trump rally? And actually, this isn't even a rally. This is a beautiful group of people. But there's really nothing like it. I mean, because there's love. There's love all over the room. Unlike Crooked Joe, who wants to dramatically increase the estate tax or the death tax, I virtually eliminated the unfair death tax. I did eliminate it, essentially, for almost everybody in this room, saving countless family farms and small businesses from destruction. You know, when you died, if you have children, great children that you love, if you don't love your children, it doesn't make a damn bit of difference. Don't leave them. Don't give them the money. But if you love your children, if you love your children, who loves their children? Okay. Who doesn't love their children? Oh, she raised her hand. Now, if you don't love your children, don't listen. This is just a waste of words. But if you do, you want to leave the farm, you want to leave the business, you have no estate tax. They used to, if you left the farm, they would almost always go bankrupt because they had to go to a bank, they had to borrow the money. You know, it's a great business, but it's cash intensive, land rich a little bit. We all know that through real estate, right? But farms are great, but they're, you know, it's tough. So you leave the farm to your kids, you love your kids, you say goodbye to your kids, they're great. And then they end up losing the farm over a period of 2, 3, 4 years. I ended that. I ended the estate tax or the death tax, as we call it. I also ended the NAFTA disaster, the worst trade deal ever made, and replaced it with the brand new USMCA, the best trade deal ever made, a giant win for Iowa farmers. That was a big win for the Iowa farmers. And you know why we all know it's so good? It's because China, you have to see this. China, by the way, I think maybe my best deal is with China, but I don't talk about it too much because I'm so angry about COVID, but maybe the best deal. But if you look at the USMCA, Mexico and Canada, they're trying to renegotiate the deal. They want to renegotiate that deal so much because we made a much better deal than they did. And they're trying to, you know, for years they took advantage of us with NAFTA. But Mexico and Canada are trying to renegotiate the deal. And I tell the Biden administration, don't do it. Don't do it. We had to suffer with NAFTA. Now you do, and you know that. The deal we made, USMCA, Mexico, Canada, it's the greatest trade deal ever made in this country. It's an amazing deal. And they want to change it. Don't change it. Don't let them change it. Talk to your senators. They'll do a lot for you. I took on communist China like no administration in history, bringing hundreds of billions of dollars pouring into our treasury when no other president had ever gotten even 10 cents from China. And then I gave you, out of all of those billions of dollars, I gave the farmers $28 billion. And it is funny, though, because my people keep saying, don't talk about it, sir. It's demeaning. I said, wait a minute. It's like you're taking advantage. You shouldn't say it to the people of Iowa. Don't say it, sir, because it sounds too contemptuous. I say, listen, I got Iowa $28 billion for their farmers. They're never voting against me. They vote against me. Do you think that Biden lays awake in his bed, turning and tossing, thinking about how he's going to screw China? I don't think so. They lay awake thinking about how they're going to screw him, but it doesn't work the other way. No, I got you $28 billion, and somehow I'm not overly worried. I'm not overly worried. And I know that sounds a little bit brash, but the farmers appreciate it. I said, remember, I said, just stick with me. We're going to make a great deal. And the farmers stuck with me. They never – I'll remember an interview on one of the shows in the morning, and they said to one of the farmers – and, you know, there was a period of time when they really cut us off and it was a tough negotiation. And this farmer said, no, President Trump's right. We're dying right now, but he's right. He's going to get this thing. Because for 30 years, you were getting, the farmer was really getting hurt in this country. And this farmer said, no, it's very tough, but I'm sticking with President Trump. And very shortly after that, we made a deal that was unbelievable. $50 billion they had to buy. And I said, what are they buying now? I asked Sonny Perdue, Secretary of Agriculture, who is a good guy, by the way. I said, Sonny, so tell me, how much did they take advantage of the farmers in our country? And he said, comes back 2 days later, about $28 billion. I said, good, I'm going to give them $28 billion from China. And I gave them checks. A lot of the people in this room got it. And I said, you're going to go two things, buy more land and bigger tractors. Remember my line? I said, buy more land and bigger tractors. And that's what happened, and you're doing great with it. But don't let them change that one either, because that one's up. And as you know, Biden is a man who is very compromised with China. He's a Manchurian candidate. Does anybody know what a Manchurian candidate is? Because he is a Manchurian candidate. He's paid off by China, so he may do bad things. Just as I promised, I also stood up for Iowa ethanol. I issued a historic rule declaring that E15 would be made available all year round. Nobody thought that would ever be done. And letting them use existing pumps and existing equipment, which saved hundreds of millions of dollars for your state. And Ron DeSantis spent his entire career as a raging opponent of ethanol. He was an opponent. Now, all of a sudden, I see I'm with ethanol. This guy spent every year in Congress trying to kill the farmer. He was against the farmer, and he was against ethanol. But he'll destroy ethanol, and I'll protect ethanol for 4 more years. You'll have total protection in the White House. You know, when a politician, because I know politics for a long time, but always on the other side until the last period of time. But when a politician says something initially, that's what they always do. So Ron DeSantis was against Social Security. Now he comes out in favor of Social Security. He wanted to cut the hell out of it. That's where his inclination is. Same thing with Nikki. That's where their inclination is. And they always go back after the election. They go back to it. Just like they try and reduce gas prices, and after the election, it goes up like a rocket ship, you know, which is what they're trying to do right now, Biden. Before I even arrive at the Oval Office, shortly after we win the presidency, it's going to be us all together. I will have the horrible war between Russia and Ukraine settled. I know them both very well, Zelensky and Putin. I'll get it settled. We will turn, it's a terrible war. Millions of people are dying. You know, it's far worse than they are not giving you the real numbers. The number of people that are dying is far greater. When those massive buildings come tumbling down, there are a lot of people in those buildings. And then they say, yeah, there were 2 people hurt. No, there were a lot of people killed every time a rocket hits a building. It's terrible. But we'll get it settled quickly. We will turn the page forever on the days of foolish, never-ending wars that squander American blood and treasure in distant foreign lands. And we will restore peace through strength. We can do it. We can do it very easily. We don't have to go out and lose our young people and our wealth. And I'm the only candidate who can make this promise to you. I will prevent World War III. You are very close to World War III. Very close. Very close. You're very close to World War III, far closer than most of the people in this room would understand. And we will prevent World War III. And this would be a war with nuclear. And I don't even want to tell you about the destructive capability, but this would be obliteration. This is not World War II with the armored tanks going back and forth shooting at each other. This is obliteration. I will end Biden's inflation nightmare, save our nation from debt and economic despair, and we will immediately drill, baby, drill. Drill, baby, drill. Immediately. In fact, you know, when you give the speech at the White House, at the Capitol, and you have the stairs going up, the beautiful stairs with the red carpet going up. I'm so anxious to get some of these things signed, like closing up the border, like getting out all the criminals that are coming to our country, like drill, baby, drill, and other things, that I think rather than going back to the Oval Office, which is somewhat of a little track, I'll put a desk about 5 steps up. It's many steps. And I'll sit down at that desk, and I'll sign all of the things that we're talking about tonight so I don't waste a lot of time. On day one. And I'll also cancel Crooked Joe Biden's insane ethanol-killing electric vehicle mandate. How crazy is that? Crazy. And don't sell your gas stove, because you'll be using your gas stove for a long time. That's another thing. People that are great cooks say gas is much better than electric. You know, what do I know about it? I really wouldn't know, but they say the gas is much better than electric, and you're not going to be using electric if you don't want to. You're going to have the option. Same thing with cars. They don't go far. They're very expensive, and they're going to all be made in China because China has the materials. But we have the materials called gasoline. We have the materials for what we want. And I'm not against the electric cars, but if you want a hybrid, you can have it. And if you want, but you can have a lot of choice. And that's the way it has to be, to mandate electric. How can you do this? And we don't have enough electric. And, you know, electric is produced by fossil fuel. Okay? You know, people don't say that. You know, all that fossil fuel is really getting it done. But just as I did before, I will appoint strong, highly qualified, pro-Constitution Supreme Court justices who will interpret the law as written. And I will direct a completely overhauled DOJ to investigate every radical, out-of-control prosecutor in America for their illegal, racist enforcement of the law. And I'm also going to indemnify all police officers and law enforcement officials throughout the United States to protect them from being destroyed by radical left lunatics for taking strong action on crime. We're going to indemnify them because they get sued. And a lot of police departments now, they say you have to protect yourself. You have to go out and hire your own lawyer to protect. Can you believe it? We're going to indemnify them and some of the departments themselves. We're going to rebuild our cities into beacons of hope, safety, and beauty better than they have ever been before. We'll have to work with the Democrats. They're all running these decaying cities. The cities are decaying. They're crime-ridden. They're crime-infested. Every one of them is run by a Democrat. Safety will again be restored so that children can go outside and play in the park without being beat up, molested, or shot. And we're also going to federalize Washington, D.C. It's become hell on earth. Three people were killed last night. People are being shot every day in Washington, D.C. Graffiti all over the beautiful white marble columns. Slum areas that are so bad you can't walk through them. But you can't even walk through the best areas without being molested or shot, beat up by thugs. We're going to take over Washington, D.C., and we're going to make it great again. We're going to make it beautiful and safe. We're also going to fight to give you much better health care than Obamacare, which is a disaster. You know that, because it's so expensive. It's out of control. It's out of control. And I'm not saying anything about Obama. Maybe we'll make it better. Maybe we'll change it. But you're going to have much better health care at a much lower price. And you don't have that now. On day one, I will sign a new executive order to cut federal funding for any school pushing critical race theory, transgender insanity, and other inappropriate racial, sexual, or political content onto our children. And I will not give one penny to any school that has a vaccine mandate or a mask mandate. And I will keep men out of women's sports. Can you believe we even have to say that? Can you believe we even have to say that? Did you hear now they want to box against men? They want to box. I know something about that. They want to box. They don't want to. I think the men probably don't mind it, actually. But they want to box now. How stupid, how crazy. Do you even have to say this? So many of the things that you're saying today, if you ever said them 10 years ago, they say, why do they even say that? Like, I will give you back your parental rights. Of course you have your parental rights. They took away your parental rights. They're giving them to school boards. I will fully uphold the Second Amendment, which I've done better than anybody. And we will protect innocent life, and we will restore free speech. And almost the most important, I will secure our elections. Our goal will be one day voting with paper ballots and voter ID. Right? But until then, Republicans must win. And I will say that Republican governors should switch to paper right now. I don't know why they're not. You know, they should switch. They're Republicans. They control the state. And if they do have that kind of control, they ought to switch over. Many states have really good control. They ought to switch over to paper ballots. It's all watermarked now. It's really incredible stuff what you can do with paper. Paper is actually high tech. But paper, you can switch over to it. Voter ID you want. Why wouldn't they want voter ID? You know, the Democrats fight you on voter ID. You know why? Because they want to cheat. They don't want to have voter ID. Everything has voter. Everything has an identification. Even the Democrat National Convention, when you walked into that, the last convention they had a sign. It was like a painting on the front. It had your picture from four different angles. It had everything about you. And that was for their convention. But for voting, they don't want you to have any identification whatsoever. It's only for, very simply, they want to cheat. They cheat like nobody has ever cheated before. So if you want to save America from crooked Joe Biden, then get every patriot you know, make sure they're registered Republicans, and get them out to vote in their local precinct caucus at 7 p.m. Monday, January 15th. And I'm going to be here for doing that. I'm going to be in Iowa. And remember, you're first in the nation because I kept you first in the nation. I kept you there. Nobody else, no other politician. I kept you there. I know the governor I called, and I said, when are you endorsing me? Well, sir, I'd rather remain neutral. And I said, well, when you called me a number of years ago, I endorsed you and I got you elected. I even moved Terry Branstad to China, right? I moved him to China, your governor. He was, he did a very good job. He did a very good job. Well, sir, I'd rather remain neutral. I said, well, I would have rather remained neutral too, but I didn't. I got you elected. So it's a whole thing, but we got you first in the nation, and that's a big deal, and we love it. And, you know, you're a great political state, in a sense. When I hear Iowa, I think of farmers and I think of politics, so we're going to keep it that way. You have a great tradition here. They wanted to move you to the back of the pack. Look, the Democrats left. They left, which I think was foolish. There was no reason for it, but they left. And you're first in the nation because of me, and I'm going to keep you there, too. I'll keep you there. The whole world is watching, so learn how to caucus and find your caucus location, which is often different than where you're normally, when you normally vote. It's a little bit different. It's ia.donaldjtrump.com. So remember that. Go just caucus and bring people and just make sure we win big, because that's going to set the table for November. So in conclusion, from Fort Dodge to Cedar Rapids, from Des Moines to Davenport, from Sioux City to Iowa City to right here in Mason City, we stand on the shoulders of generations of Iowa patriots who tamed the wilderness, braved the elements, tilled the soil, worked the fields, built the factories, and poured out their blood, sweat, and tears to make this country into the greatest nation in the history of the world. But now we are a nation in decline. We are a nation in very, very serious decline. We're a failing nation. We're a nation that has lost its confidence, its willpower, and its strength. Think how horrible that sounds. We're a nation that's lost its confidence. We are. We have lost its confidence because we have horrible leaders that shouldn't be the leaders. We're a nation that has lost its way, but we are not going to allow this horror to continue. 3 years ago, we were a great nation, and we will soon be a great nation again. It was hardworking patriots, and that's what you are. You're incredible patriots like you who built this country, and it's hardworking patriots like you who are going to save our country. We will fight for America like no one has ever fought before. 2024 is our final battle. It's our final battle. Got to do it. And remember, this is the greatest movement in the history of our country. You know, you've had people come along and they did well in one primary. They might have won a primary unexpectedly. Or Pat Buchanan, I think about him. He did well in Iowa. I think he came in second and he made a career of being a great political pundit because of that. I mean, we won last time. We won 50 states, right? Last time we did numbers that nobody's ever done, the largest number of votes in the history of our country. Bad things happen, really bad things. We can't let that happen again. But we got more votes than any sitting president by far in the history of our country. And in 2016, some people thought it was a surprise. I didn't think it was a surprise because we had rallies that were so massive. But we have bigger rallies now than we did then. We have bigger rallies now than we had in 2020, and they were big. They were big, and, you know, we did incredible. But we're going to do better this time. We're going to do so good, but we're going to be watching. You know, it's called secure the ballot. We have to secure. We have all the votes we need. We have to secure the ballot. And with you at my side, we will demolish the deep state. We will expel the warmongers. We're going to get them out of our government. They are not good. Look, there'll be a time. Maybe there'll be a time, but there's no reason for it. You can get things settled and a lot better. Ukraine's an example. That could have been settled so easy. I would have had that done in 24 hours. That could have been settled so easy. All those dead people, all those buildings that are gone, those cities that are gone, 2,000 years old, domes that are 1,500 years old, you can't replace them. But so many people have died. We could have solved that. Israel would have never been attacked, ever. Not even a chance, or that horror show. What they did in Israel was a horror thing, a horrible thing. All the people dead. And from both sides, now you look at what's happening the other way. From both sides, we would have never had that. We'll get that settled and solved, too. Somehow we'll get it solved. But we'll drive out the globalists. We'll cast out the communists, Marxists, and fascists. We'll throw off the sick political class that hates our country. They hate our country. We'll rout the fake news media, and we will evict crooked Joe Biden from the White House on election night 2024. We have to get him out of there. He's bad. He's a bad guy, bad person. The great silent majority is rising like never before, and under our leadership, the forgotten man and woman will be forgotten no longer. We're not going to be forgetting the men and women of this country. We will love our country. We will take care of our country. We will pray to God for our strength and for our liberty. We will pray for God, and we will pray with God. We are one movement, one people, one family, and one glorious nation under God. And together we will make America powerful again. We will make America wealthy again. We will make America strong again. We will make America proud again. We will make America safe again. And we will make America great again. Thank you, Iowa. Get out there. We love you. God bless you all. God bless you.